LINQ is a powerful library, but it is not almighty. It is not complete, for one thing. I don't even know what complete would mean there. So what do you do when you encounter a situation when there is no appropriate LINQ operator that you need? Will you fall back to good old procedural programming? Or will you produce a custom LINQ operator of your own? In this video, I will show you how you can create custom LINQ operators that are indistinguishable from the existing ones in the way they operate and in the effects they produce. Let's get to code. Suppose that there is a sequence of data you're receiving and you have a very specific request to implement. To take the last n elements of this sequence. We don't know how many items there are, and so, after a minute of thinking, it comes to mind to use a queue to store the remaining items until the last n remain. Let me show you a very simple algorithm that will solve this request. Pass all the input items through the queue, but every time enqueuing would breach the limit of n elements, dequeue one element before appending the new one. After this loop completes, the queue would contain the last n elements of the original sequence, so this is the sequence we wanted to have. And now comes the rest of the request, like formatting for printout, turning the last n elements into a CSV list, and printing them on the console. Let's suppose that this was the request and we have just implemented it. I can run the application and you will see that it really shows the last 12 elements from that original list of numbers from 1 through 100. But I'm not satisfied. What do we see here? These are the input data and the algorithm parameter. Those are the things we are given from the outside. Then comes the general algorithm to shape the data. It is implemented right in the middle of the operation that was supposed to implement customers' requests. This is too general for the place where it is located. In the end, I'm collecting the desired result, then formatting the result into a CSV list, and finally printing it out. Everything is mixed together. That's what I don't like with this solution. And what if I shown you the original request? Here it is. Receive a sequence of items and print the CSV list containing the last n items. Here is the input and parameters collecting, and here is printing out the CSV list. Everything else is infrastructure. Everything else does not belong here. One solution is to introduce our own LINQ. Look here. An operator to convert to a CSV list. This operator is more general than integers I'm applying it to, so I must also think about null references supporting reference types. But with that done correctly, I can remove the formatting part of my code and focus on the request. Just print the last elements, convert it to CSV. What about finding the last n elements? Okay, move it into a similar extension method. What was the request then? Wasn't it to take the last n items, print as CSV? One line of code. One line of code, because we have operators that are doing all infrastructural work for us. But now, forget about using this operator. Focus on the operator. That is not the only use of this operator when you see it like this. Anyone can call it. This implementation is violating the common rules of LINQ. It is with immediate execution. Call the operator and it will immediately consume the entire input sequence and prepare the queue with the last n elements and then return that collection. That is immediate execution. But it is returning IEnumerable. We don't expect operators that return IEnumerable to be immediate. We expect them to be deferred. We want them to start consuming the input only when we start iterating their result. And someone might be surprised to see our operator working differently from anything else they know about. Lucky for us, there is a very easy way to turn this operator into a deferred operator. For each through the queue and yield return every item it contains. Now, this form will create a state machine during compilation. The first state in that state machine will be everything until the first yield return, creating the queue, pulling all the data from the input sequence, passing them through the queue, will not happen until move next is first time invoked on the enumerator produced by this method. Therefore, this operator will be deferred. Now, once the move next is invoked, it will indeed pull all the data from the input sequence, pass them through the queue. It will be a deferred eager operator. There are many deferred eager operators in LINQ, like reverse or the by. That's nothing new. Some operators just need all the data before they can produce the first element on the output. That is quite natural. So this operator is really satisfying the common rules of LINQ. I'm very happy about it. Now, if you liked this video so far, please press the like button. That will help me spread the word about it. Thank you. Let's continue. Yield return is not going to just save you in every conceivable situation. Do you remember the intersect operator? That is another deferred eager operator. It must store one sequence and index it so that it can walk through the other sequence and check for every item whether it exists in the other sequence or not. That is very complicated and costly, but did you know that you can implement a much cheaper intersect method, which is deferred and lazy, under a condition? Only if both sequences are sorted, then you can walk through one and the other in lockstep, like what merge sort would do. It will implement the iterator pattern explicitly. You will rarely ever have to implement design patterns such as the iterator on your own. You would normally rely on for each, and the iterator will be implemented for you. But when you get down to the level of the library code, implementing design patterns like iterator is a commonplace. Look here. I must check whether any of the two input sequences is empty. If so, then the intersection is empty and I quit early. Otherwise, we begin. We compare the two current elements because we know at this stage that both sequences have the current element, and that requires T to be comparable. Okay, let's move. Now comes the logic. If both current elements are equal, then the current element, for example, of the first sequence, belongs to the intersection. We yield return that one. And beyond this point, we need to advance one or both sequences, enumerators. If the left enumerator is lagging behind, move it. But if it didn't move, then the left-hand sequence has been exhausted, and there will be no more elements in the intersection, so quit. Read this line of code carefully. Spoiler alert, it is correct. And this is the entire implementation, a bit cryptic, a bit hard to understand, of another lazy deferred LINQ operator, this time looking for the intersection of two sorted sequences. Let me show you how we can apply this new operator. These numbers are the beginning of the Fibonacci sequence. I want to intersect them with numbers from the first sequence. Then turn that into a CSV list and print on the console. One-liner again. Let me run the application. I'm eager to see the output. That is the intersection of the Fibonacci sequence and that sequence of the first 100 numbers. Both operators are working fine. If you want to see this source code, follow the instructions from the description. Besides that, I hope you have learned how to create your own link operators that are 100% aligned with how existing link operators work. Thank you for staying till the end of this video. Like this video, subscribe to my channel, and see you in the next episode.